morning. My name is Linda Loy, and I'm an Alamance County Master Gardener. Welcome. So, I'm thinking about my audience, and I knew all of my friends and colleagues would be here. I'm going to try to keep it very informative, and you all, I'm sure, know things about bulbs and plants that you've planted that I haven't planted. There are some particular favorites I have, and you'll see in just a moment. I don't claim to be the expert on getting and growing summer bulbs, but I feel like I have some wisdom about the subject. So thank you so much for coming out today. And for those of you who don't know, I'm also part of a garden team, and several of the garden members are here. Luann McAdams, Linda Douglas, Jackie has helped us, and Gail Thompson. We garden over at the historic Hawfields Presbyterian Schoolhouse, which was an original schoolhouse from the late 1800s. And so I have two garden spaces. I live in a historic home. I live in the Scott home up on 119, corner of Jim Minor. Indianapolis is what I usually call it. Indianapolis Boulevard and 119. And two things have happened in the last 6 months. One is that my husband and I have finally finished the fence, a 12-foot fence, all the way around the property. Let's hear it for that. So I don't have to talk about deer. I do have to talk about other kinds of critters. But the second thing is I had my eyes repaired so I can actually see what I'm planting now. So by welcome, we're going to talk about some things that I hope you will be inspired to plant. I hope that some of you will know that there are all kinds of bulbs to plant, and we're going to talk about bulbs, and there are other names for them, but scientifically most of you won't get your PhD or your master's degree in botany. But if you know you want to just call them bulbs, that's perfectly okay with most everybody. So Miss Chris, how do I do it? Oh, advance. There we go. So planting a summer bulb like a stargazer lily, and feel free to ooh if you really feel that. Or a dinner plate dahlia. Summer bulbs are often the answer to any beautiful arrangement. There would be hard pressed to know who the star was, and all those came from my Melville garden. My home is an 1848 home, 5 acres. It was the historic home of Governor Scott and his father, Carr Scott. It's on the corner of, like I said, 119, a busy highway. And we have secured, our main purpose now is to protect and propagate and preserve this historic home, which will never, there'll never be another home like that. Why grow bulbs at all? Well, those of you who know me, I'm a sort of a silent bee person, although I am a bee person. This is a fountain outside my kitchen. Bee food is one of the answers. Everything we eat has to have fertilization. And who does that? Well, we know the girls do that. So if we can help them and feed them, we will. The second answer is we must teach children about bulbs and all plants. Here's a little note, a little love note somebody wrote me. I love when we planted flowers and learning about the flowers, unsolicited from children. That's the best, isn't it? There are about 50 children who've been through 4 years of gardening with the garden team, and so we're pretty thrilled that they're getting there. And here is that famous Luann McAdams. Let's hear it. Woohoo! The junior gardeners have planted many, many, many things, including spring bulbs, and here they are down on their knees, looky, looky, planting some daffodils, which, by the way, all came up, and all the tulips came up. So around the historic Hawfields Church, you can see their handiwork. And here we're planting summer bulbs in the historic garden. So if you look at these cute kids, they're really studying, they're really paying attention. So it can work. All right, so there's lots of names. Bulbs, tubers, corms, oh my. There's hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of varieties of summer bulbs. So we're going to talk about some that are kind of fun. Again, the time to get summer blooms is spring. So you're going to plant now. Now is when you plant. And you can begin planting. If you're lucky, you can begin planting in March and April. because the soil will be a little ready to do. If you plant any earlier, you plant anything like a calla lily, it's going to turn to mush. So you don't want to plant things like calla lilies because they have to have soil temperatures in the 70s. So, and their feet don't like to be wet, so you're just going to lose your money on that. A bulb is next year's plant, neatly packaged, surrounded by scale leaves, immature leaves, flower stems, and sometimes even flower buds. And the whole bulb is neatly wrapped in a, I like to say it, in a party pack, in a party package, just like your daffodils, in skin called tunic. So shake your head if you know what I'm talking about. A daffodil has tunic. So I was digging yesterday because I had to find one. I hate to be a liar. There's the tunic. It was in the wrong place anyway. It was in full shade, bad thing. So the tunic wraps the bulb. So we're going to call them all bulbs for sake of argument. But most things do have a specific name, particularly dahlias that have tubers. And they'll look just like a potato with an eye, and you'll see it. Ooh, it's got an eye. I should put it right in the ground. Yes, you should. So, bulbs. Now, I just want to say this because this is what all master gardeners always ask about. What about the soil? Yeah, what about the soil? If your soil is not humus, organic, rich, emulsified, happy, your bulbs will not be happy either. It's like any other plant that you plant. You must have well-drained, organically happy soil. And you'll know because you'll stick your hand down. You almost don't even need a trowel or that wonderful tool we all got, the garden knife, yes. You won't even need that because you can almost dig down in there. So this is a lovely dinner plate dahlia that I put in. All right, a tuber is the part of the plant that stores energy for later, and it plays a role in this asexual vegetative reproduction. It's the tip of an underground stem, also called a rhizome. So a lot of times you'll see rhizomes. You'll see a dahlia. They'll even call it a rhizome. Potatoes, Jerusalem artichokes. The reason that it's important to know it's a tuber is it's not wrapped in that skin. So that's just part of the way it is. However, dahlia tubers are the fleshy stems of the dahlia plant, and they grow underground and they sprout those eyes. So, hello. So you're going to see, and I'm going to open some up so you can see, gardeners can grow dahlia tubers by cutting a clump of tubers. So if you get a big old package and it's all kind of separated, you can plant those individual tubers and they will eventually sprout. Now if you grow dahlias by seed, you're going to need a very patient journey because they don't grow fast. To get a tuber, it takes 10, 11 years, sometimes longer in some of these dinner plates. So don't buy seeds, just go for the clumps of tubers, if you will, the rhizomes. And of course, a corm is a rounded underground storage unit. And we all know that the most example of that are gladiolas, right? Right, shake your head. Yeah, that's right, Linda. So glads are just wonderful little flowers, and they are the most stalwart and colorful of flowers, except for the dahlias, of course, in our gardens. And they're easy to grow, and you put the corms in, and if you're really careful, you can get lovely, lovely flowers, and you can even know that they'll come back, even though sometimes they shouldn't. They do come back, because we live in North Carolina, Zone 7B, you know. Mother Nature, you know who she is. She's a carefully crafted woman, isn't she? Just when you think you have it all figured out, she's going to fool you. Go ahead and smile at that one because I know it. So, everybody, there's a handout. Did you get it? So let's just kind of fly through that. We're going to talk about many of these. Begonias, caladiums, callas, canas, dahlias, glads. Now, I didn't put Dutch iris in my presentation because Dutch iris you plant in the fall. So make yourself a little note. This handout I got from Logan's in Raleigh. And Logan's in Raleigh is a nice place to get all kinds of plants that are already growing, but also to get lovely packages of tubers and bulbs. Foxtail lilies, Crocosmia, doesn't that sound lovely? Crocosmia, what did you plant today, Barbara? I planted the Crocosmia, Linda. It just sounds like you know things. Linda, what did you plant? I planted those lovely Montbrésia courgettes. So it sounds like you're from France. All right, so begonias. This is where you can ooh. Oh, I planted peach-colored and pink-colored tuberous begonias. They're beautiful flowers. Do you know there's over 1,000 varieties of them? Go ahead and put that down. That just knocked my socks off. First of all, who's got the money to buy 1,000? But anyway, you buy the plants already, or you can put the tubers in. So they come in tubes. They come in tubes. Does anybody have a peach-colored or a... Oh, Gail's got it. Pass it to her. Happy begonia planting. Now, here's the character part. This is sitting down in a huge pot. I mean, we're talking a 5-foot pot. So it'll be happy. And it's coming back in a container. They plant tuberous begonias around your trees, in the ground, by your garden. It's going to say, I want to please you, but I'm not coming back. You understand what I'm saying? So if you want to spend that kind of money to let flowers go to waste, otherwise, you be right, the first frost, you dig them up. Okay? Chances are in the container they're going to be beautiful, and mine are beautiful. So has that been your case? Anybody can testify to that? Okay. So this is a beautiful, beautiful area. This is light shade. It's perfect for this. I mulched that top of that container down about 6 inches of pure mulch. And I use coffee grounds, and I use banana peels, and I grind up eggshells too. And because I live on a farm and I have chickens, that's very handy. Mm-hmm. So you want to dump that kind of thing in. You know, the thing that's very important about begonias, make yourself a little note, they like high humidity, which is North Carolina. Mm-hmm. They love cool nights. That's North Carolina. They do not grow well in hot, arid New Mexico soil, so you won't see begonias there. They love morning light best. And here's the other thing about all of this besides soil. Please don't overwater your begonias. They just get real icky and soggy and just look silly. All right, did you make a note of that? Don't overwater. Caladiums and elephant ears, best known in the shade for beautiful leaves. The color of the plant is the leaf. Now, I've learned a long time ago that, you know, I follow my own advice, so I learned that the caladiums and elephant ears must be dug up. They are not going to come back in North Carolina. They do best in zones 8 through 10. But the leaf is the color, and the elephant ear is just the showy leaf. Even with that bed mulched down, no, it did not come up. I know. Caladiums do not overwinter. Make yourself a note. They just don't. I like to plant them under trees. I like to plant them where you need a sort of a spot of color where there's a possibility that nothing else will grow. They grow lovely in shade. Now this area now is probably 8 inches of absolute black gold soil. So they're happy, happy, happy. Again, your soil makes the big difference in all of that. This is not my garden. All these pictures in this slide projection are my garden, but this I have not grown these. Foxtail lilies or desert candles or eremuus, best grown in full sun, striking color. This is a garden in England. Yellow, pink, red. They prefer hot sun. So if you have a nice area, and you can buy foxtail lilies here. Some of you are going to say, well, where do you get them? Well, this particular baby was sold, of all places, at Walmart. I know. Who knew? Somebody's buying well. And I'll let you take a peek at it if you'd like. The thing about it is, it's just a candle, and it burns, and then the candle's done. These may overwinter if they're mulched down. Hopefully, you will find that to be true. You're going to plant these tuberous roots about 4 inches deep, and they will be planted 2 to 3 feet apart, and you'll get that kind of a showy thing. So the most important part about bulbs, good morning, is that you're going to find some really beautiful flowers, and that's really important. Well, mm-hmm. come on, who doesn't love a Glad? Mm-hmm. It's kind of like the workhorse bulb, isn't it? This is planted up close to the church. And I love it because they're different multicolors. Glads, as I said earlier, are corms. And you plant them, and by mid-July, late July, you've got beautiful, beautiful plants. Many need to be staked, they're so tall. But they're just really reliable plants. Again, if your soil's good, you're going to get beautiful color. If your soil's clay, they're going to be straggly and wrinkly. And it looks like you don't know what you're doing. And for some of you, that's the death. Because people come to your garden and go, oh, you're a master gardener. What happened to your glads? I have no clue. I didn't go to Linda. I wasn't paying attention when Linda talked. All right. So not always do glads overwinter. In my garden, I have glads planted in between rows in the rose garden, and glads are coming back up. But I mulch that rose garden down 12 inches. So again, you got to work at it. So who has a blue? Well, let's just do it like this. Let's just give a peek. Does anybody have a blue thing? A blue presentation? No? Blue? Anybody have, what color do you have? Turquoise. No. I mean your pamphlet. Does anybody have a blue pamphlet? Don't be taking off your clothes in this presentation. Then you'll get that on video and I'll never be asked back. All right, well, obviously didn't get, so I'll give you some corn. All right. Please, again, remember this is a G-rated event. So, now pay attention carefully because this is the showstoppers and you're probably going to just go, Linda? If you're going to want to plant something that's going to take your breath away, this is the category of bulbs you want to go for. There are so many different forms now. They're really, North Carolina State University is experimenting with the forms of dahlias and they're mixing colors. They are doing crazy, crazy things with dahlias. Dahlia Mr. Optimist, can you believe it? Now, I know. So in it are, again, Walmart. And it's on sale, so I know you're going to scoot over there. These are all tuberous, ready to go on the ground, but look at the gorgeousness of that color. Now this is a dinner plate dahlia, we'll get to that in just a minute. Dinner plates are just bigger and more showy. But the original form of dahlia, it was just a plain old ball. It just kind of looked a little bit like a zinnia, only a little more formed. They are the kind of flowers that you cut them and they last for a week, or maybe even longer. If you're going to do a wedding for somebody special, you'll want to plant some dahlias because they're going to be beautiful. They landscape well. It takes a little work to get them going in terms of staking them, and I'll talk about that in a second. But the forms, the cactus, the bronze leaf, the semi-cactus, fubaki, the decorative, the dinner plates, they are all just amazing, amazing forms. Here's my favorite one, and that is the Café au Lait. And this one's a little pinker, but usually it does really look like you're sitting at the Café du Monde drinking your Café au Lait. It's a beautiful, beautiful plant. Now, this particular dinner plate grows 6 to 7 feet. Yes, so I'm a tall girl. I need staking sometimes too. You know, I gotta, in terms of rain and, you know, just your climate, dahlias prefer really hot sun, but they need to be watered. They can't just go without water. So, you know, they need to be watered. But they also need to be staked down with rebar kinds of supports because they're heavy. So you can get some of those really sturdy stakes, or you can get tomato stakes, but you have to stake the dinner plates because their heads are, this head was 8 inches across. Now you can imagine it doesn't take many to put in a pot, right? All right, we'll go through here. I was practicing for the state fair. I don't know, I had an idea. These are all different forms. You can see the cactus yellow one on the right, in different colors. There's small blooms, there's large blooms, and I just was feeling kind of dahlia-like that day. And I mixed it in with some of my sweet Annie and, of course, some other little things. Here's a small dahlia, the Creme de Cassis, a very beautiful cut flower. It's very small. It's about maybe an inch across and grows low. Don't need to stake this, but beautiful, beautiful, true purple. I know. It's a nice fill-in dahlia, and if you haven't seen it, easy to get. And here's a new form. It's the star. It's actually the orchid form, and it's shaped like a star. That's the front of my garden is now, the front of my home is now just a garden. And it's just, it used to be, you know, ivy and silly stuff, and now it's all flowers. And so there she is, strutting her stuff. A cactus-style dahlia is always lovely, and this is very fringe-like. This is in my cottage garden, and you can see how fringy it is. Pure white. And then this one's gorgeous. This is dark maroon, almost black. But you see the stakes on the left? Mm-hmm. Okay. Lots of stakes. Most dinner plant dahlias, the diameter of your flower is between 4 and 6 inches. And so I have trellises and things to support them. Yes?
Your dinner plant ones that grow that tall, is it in full sun?
Yes.
And they still grow that tall?
Yes. And yes, here, you know, you have to know I'm married to an engineer, so he delights in coming up with problems. Well, you're going to have to buy more rebar, Linda. Yes, you are going to have to go down to Lowe's and get that, Tim. You with me? You have a real serious problem, Tim. We don't have enough rebar. And I, because I'm a girl, don't know much about that. So he comes back with rebar and fixes everything. But now I can do it, too. The only thing about beautiful dahlias like this is they do require to be watered. They're not going to go, you know, you can't go a month. You can't go to Italy and come back and say, what happened to my darling dahlias? They won't be happy with you. Now, isn't that a pretty color? Almost ethereal, isn't it? The thing about dahlias, they come up with more and more and more and more and more. The name of that dahlia is called Lake Michigan. Here she is. Isn't she gorgeous? She's just so special. Again, Walmart. You don't have to go to Eden Brothers, which I recommend you do, but you can supplement your dahlia fix by going locally. And quite, you know, honestly, there are lots of great nurseries everywhere. But I liked the ethereal quality of this and the color schemes. And here's a giant one. It's fuchsia colored. And she's a good 7.5 feet. And this is late August. You with me? And here's the reblooming azalea on the left. This particular cultivar bloomed from July through November. I had fresh blooms every week. Okay, well, I'm glad you like it. These are lovely. Now, I've also included, because I garden in two places, I've chosen different color schemes. These dahlias, the children planted at the historic bed. You with me? So the church needs flowers. You see my mind? The church needs flowers, and we have no money. Maybe we should plant some dahlias. La-la! And they're shrimp-colored and peach, sitting in a blue cobalt vase. There were lots of ooze that day. All right. This is a small little bloom, again. It's about the size of the cassis, about 1/2 inch. And, of course, the star dahlias are wonderful because they last for a long time and you can mix them in different colors. So so we have all kinds of dahlias. Would anybody be interested in a dahlia? Oh! What? All right. Yes. Okay, well, let's just go down the line. Excuse me, Mr. Videographer, you can't catch me. here's one for you. Here's one for you. Oh, wait, I'll just go ahead and pass these. Just take those and pass them down. Sorry. You can share with him. So dahlias are huge tubers. I was going to open that up and show you, but I thought that would create a big mess. Oh, pass that to her.
Mm-hmm.
I know. I'm going to explain that. That's an excellent question. Okay. So, two things about dahlias. Zone 7B that we are. And I will just say this from my experience, and some of you maybe have different experiences. If you plant dahlias like these, and you plant them down in good soil, and then at the end of the season, which Thanksgiving, this was my arrangement on my Thanksgiving table. Okay, you with me? Thanksgiving came and went. It wasn't real cold. Still blooming. And then I said, okay, you're done. I'm not paying attention to you anymore, you're done. And then I dumped mulch and fine mulch and fine mulch. And so I had about 8 inches and she's all coming back. They're not in containers, they're all of my dahlias are coming back. I didn't lose any. Now, the textbook says, if you look at the package I just gave you, it might say annual. The reason it says annual is because you might not be able to see it again. But Mother Nature must like me. I think it's that bee work I'm doing. She will come back if she's protected. And if we have a mild winter, which we've sort of had for a while, if it snows 14 inches, I'm moving back to Ohio. But anyway, the thing about it is, it's going to say in the package annual because they're assuming you're going to dig it up. Now you need to dig it up. If you're going to dig it up, you need to dig it up late fall, November. Dust off the dirt, put it in some sawdust or some paper that won't rot completely, or put it in very loose peat moss, chunked up in a basket. And I've done that too. But now I'm in the test your fates category. So I'm not going to dig those 400 up. I'm just going to put that on the notes. I'm not digging anybody up. I'm not digging anybody up. If you come back, lovely. If you don't, well, you just won't be planted again. But I will say this to you. Many of your expert dahlia people say the same thing. And there was a 50th anniversary of the National Dahlia Society, and they're serious people. They just had their conference in Asheville. And it said the same thing I just said, which is, you know, you can tempt fate, you can dig it up, or you can just continue doing what we're doing, which is dig up some of your showstoppers. Because some of the bulbs, the tubers, are expensive. Yeah. If you look at the handout I gave you on the Eden Brothers, you can go to Eden Brothers, which is a mail order business in Asheville. Some of the most beautiful ones I got are from Eden Brothers. But they're, you know, $8 a piece. I like the Walmart kind that are $2 too. I mean, I'm not judgmental about how much you cost as much as I wonder how I should take care of this. So now that my soil's good and I don't have deer to eat them, I can make some judicious. All right, so here's my garden. It's a long story. I put up another fence because I adopted 2 more dogs and they're big. I don't know what I was thinking that day. I felt so sorry for them. And they were big old mutts and they were like, oh, please take me home. I'm going to be killed. It's like, okay, but you can't go in my garden. And I said, if you'll come home and be sweet, okay. And one's a boxer, okay, mommy. Oh, yeah. So, you know, next thing I know, I'm like, oh, God. So I'm just telling you. So I put up another vinyl fence and helped Lowe's again. I don't know. But here's a little cottage garden with a nice fountain and all kinds of beautiful things. There's those maroon with the yellow center. There's calla. I haven't gotten to that yet, but, you know, lots and lots and lots. And on the left is my carriage house that was built in 1860. And on the right, I'll show you a picture in a minute, is my old smokehouse, and in the back is the summer kitchen. Both built 1890s. So, lots of things. Well, there's daylilies to consider, but that's another day, okay?
June.
There's a lovely person who's going to speak on that. Just a lovely person. She's, yeah. There are many types of lilies to plant, and here's one of my favorites, and it's called the Oriental type. It's highly fragrant. Highly fragrant. And you don't have to ever dig lilies up. Let's hear it for the gang.
Yeah.
You never have to dig up an Oriental lily, ever. And they just keep coming back and back, and you'll see in just a brief moment what I'm talking about. Lilies will pacify your perfume smell. You don't have to have any perfume for the rest of your life. Tell your husband just to buy you some lilies. So I'll pass this around and you'll see what I mean. Just pass them on down. Yeah. Stargazer lilies. So we're going to talk about the Oriental lilies. So here's one I love. It's got that real nice peach pink throat. Again, if you're smart, you'll remove the stamens so you won't get all stained. But honestly, so the next kind is an Asiatic lily. They come in lots of strong colors, pink, orange. They can tolerate sun. These particular little babies are sitting in a little shade in the afternoon because we live in North Carolina, and you know what North Carolina sun is like in the afternoon. Mm-hmm. You know, you don't want to plant your hydrangea. You know, you got to be careful about that. And these are yellow and pink and bicolors, and they're in my front. Let's see, are they in the front? No, they're in the back. I have some in the front right next to the tomatoes. They're shaded by the tomatoes. Yes, I plant vegetables in with my flowers. Yep, they're happy. This is a new variety, Tink Padri. It's a dwarf Asiatic lily. Look at how cute. Only grows 18 inches tall. Shows off with burgundy red flowers, and it's good for our zone. So you can find these locally. These are really nice. This is a whole new cultivar line. Lilies are, in my estimation, you know, once you have good soil, your lilies will just be stunning. So work on your soil and then think about some of these, and they will multiply happily. The tiger lilies, always in a strong color, and they grow in this form, a rubrum form. In other words, the flower grows upside down, which is always, and they have those cute little freckles. The kids love them. They call it the freckle plant. The deer love them too, but not as much as the others. I love my tiger lilies. Here's an Oriental lily called Orania. It's up close to my smokehouse. It's a yellow lily, and the throats are red. Very fragrant. My old smokehouse, and you'll see in some pictures, it looks like the old smokehouse needs to be painted. Yes, I know. This is a strong pink color lily. And this is the stargazer lily smell with the Easter lily structure. New cultivar. And here comes the rubrums that are they just are amazing. They're right outside my kitchen. So you can imagine, I walk off my kitchen deck and there's, 500 lilies. So it's a place to have a little bite. A little glass of, I don't know, maybe grape juice, something nice. Hundreds of blooms on this one plant. And what I love, it gets morning sun, and there's no maintenance to this flower. You stake it, you get your soil ready, you stake it, and there she goes. You don't have to go over there and say, come on, honey. They just grow. Don't you love that? I'm not even cutting off the stamens and the thistles. Just go ahead and bloom. This is a stargazer lily rubrum form, so because the flower is upside down. It's in that form of upside downness.
Why would you cut out the stamens?
Because it stains everybody. It stains your clothes, stains your face. If you have somebody you really don't like, invite them to smell them. You know, again, Mother Nature is a character. Why she did that, I don't know. So you see, even my sticks had to go. This is the side of my house. And this particular stargazer lily, which I've passed around some of your things, I started very simple. I planted one rubrum stargazer lily. And on that plant, look how many. There were almost 50 flowers. And it bloomed for a solid month. Mm. I know. Who knew Walmart was so happy? This is right outside my den window, so there you have it. Again, when you plant a lily, you want to plant it where you can enjoy the smell, the fragrance, the sight line. You know, if you're trying to spiff up your house to sell, man, put in a stargazer lily and you'll be very happy because it'll pass something along to your next friend. Again, I had to put another fence up because I have a big boxer. But that's okay when you come see it. If you come see it, you'll understand why. Mm-hmm. Beautiful soil, lovely, lovely, lovely spot. Now this is a Casablanca lily. It's white. It is the most fragrant of the lilies, and the bloom starts at 6 inches and goes up to 12 inches. Mm-hmm. It's a huge flower.
Mm-hmm. So you can find that now.
Oh, yeah. Well, Eden Brothers should have them, and you could also go to White Lily Farm. Where you want to get some of the big blooms are at the White. What did I call it? It's White Flower Farm. Sorry. I planted four yellow ones yesterday. Just because it was fun to do. You can see the ethereal quality of this flower. It's gorgeous. And the bees love them. It's a good bee food, girls. All right, now this is what they look like right now. They are 4 feet tall. You see my kitchen deck? These are right on the very edge of the kitchen deck. They are 4 feet headed taller. This is what they look like right now. I thought that would be helpful to you. I haven't staked them yet. I should have already. Yes, ma'am.
I have a question. I have stargazer lily.
Yes, ma'am.
And minor coming up.
Good.
But when I planted them, that area had more sun than it has now. My trees have gotten bigger.
Okay. Okay.
So they're getting morning sun, but not afternoon.
That's okie dokie.
That's what I mean.
Okie dokie.
I don't know if I can move them.
No, I wouldn't move them now. I would keep them right where they are. They'll tell you. They'll probably be happier because you don't have to water them so much.
Right. Okay.
Yeah, these get morning sun and then afternoon a little, but again, that's all right. I have a hummingbird vine on the trellis of a pergola above, so they're getting some shade too. Mm-hmm. You know, Mother Nature sometimes puts the seed in for a good reason. Mm-hmm. Callas, go ahead. Calla lilies are exquisite blooms. They can tolerate full sun, and again, you don't have to dig those suckers up. They come in gorgeous colors, shrimp, salmon, red, yellow. Okay. They can tolerate full sun. These I planted, and they were short, so that was good because I had a need for shorter ones. They can grow as up to, you know, 8, 10, 12 inches tall. These are shorter. And these are right against this is what I see outside my office window. They're white ones against the black and blue salvia. I think that's a nice mix. Mm-hmm. Easy to grow. No fussing. I'm up, mommy. Just give me a little water. Just leave me alone. Mm-hmm. Give me a book. I'll be fine. Don't you love that? Because, you know, the antithesis of easy maintenance is the rose garden. You with me? Mm-hmm. Dig every single one of those damn things up. Sorry. Edit that out. So July comes around and you're thinking, oh, my garden is no longer pretty. Yes, it is. Put in some canna, put in some crocosmia, and some crinum. Here, this is not my garden. This is an English garden. Here's a canna, and in the background are the red crocosmia. pretty. And here's the red giant Monbrotia crocosmia. I really did look for, this is obviously a shutterstock, but isn't that a pretty bloom?
Mm-hmm.
Looks a little freesia-like. Again, you know, depending on where you plant it and how our winters are, you can safely say it may come back, it may not. I would overwinter it or I'd pull it out. So you can have that the following year. I know, wouldn't that be a great trip to take to Devon, England? You know, because we have so much free time now. Did y'all think when you retired you'd have free time? Raise your hand. Don't you think now you're just like, what did I do with my day before I was master gardening the world? Again, no pun intended, I just think this is exquisite. And, you know, obviously someone really has done well and the soil is beautiful. So this is my garden. Some boxwoods are going to come out, but the Bengal tiger canna with the variegated leaves, it grows about 4 feet and it can tolerate full sun. Many of my cannas are in what I'd consider, they get really good morning light, and I haven't dug those up either. I love the leaf, don't you? Now the thing about all of the canas, the Red King Humbert, the flowers are beautiful. They look orchid-like. Here, pass that down to those chicks. Right there. Yeah. If you haven't planted a canna, give it a whirl. You got to mulch it down well at the end of the season. And again, it's very important that your soil be well-drained because they can't sit in mush. Okay. So a little work. A long benefit. Mm-hmm. All right, yes.
You can pay yours.
I just smack them around a lot. I have put them in pots. Again, and I've also clipped them. I've spoken to them nicely. So far, we're doing all right. And that same philosophy is not working with my mint.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. I mean, I ripped it out and burned it. And it's, hi, here I am. Did you think you might pick me? So this is a new flower to me. Many master gardeners in this room are skilled at this flower and bulb. I have not become skilled in this, but I'm sharing this with you because if you haven't planted it, it's worthwhile. Crinums, they're in beautiful colors. The flowers are fragrant. You want to plant them in groups for obvious reason, then you'll have an effective color. This one, now again, putting the plug for our Master Gardener sale in the fall, we always have some. And if you're not here the first day, well, that's just too bad because you won't get them. This is Ellen Bosconet, a crinum. It's a member of the Amaryllis family. It grows on sturdy, rigid spikes, and they're called scapes. They can get 12 inches, but they can also, some of the new cultivars can get taller. So I'm going to work on this. Sometimes they're shorter, depends on the cultivars. They've mixed, they're doing all kinds of things at NC State. They've mixed crinums with amaryllis, mm-hmm. and you know amaryllis are just spectacular flowers. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, wouldn't that be a great degree to get, to be able to mix up your own variety of beautiful flowers? I think that would just be so special. There you have it. I love it when truth comes out. So, you know, I could talk all day. One of my favorite plants ever, and it's not real spectacular, but they're so useful to the garden and to my stomach, are the alliums. And it's a true bulb. You don't have to do much with that true bulb except stick it in the ground. These are those giant Biltmore garden alliums in my back garden. Garlic, if you will. And bees absolutely adore them. The bee girls love any of the alliums you plant. You plant tall, little, the bee girls are all over umbrella plants, as I call them. They're going to be over Queen Anne's lace, they're also going to be over your garlic. So, you know, if you're thinking about the environment, you're thinking about, well, what can I do with garlic? Well, you're going to get a beautiful bulb and a beautiful flower.
Can you eat that?
Of course. You dig it out, num num.
Mm.
And then you have to replace it, of course, because then you have a hole.
Yeah.
I plant alliums everywhere, particularly in my borders. And here's a smaller allium. It's up close to my house, as you can see behind it, that's in shade. Okay? And society garlic is a smaller allium. It's a smaller of the version of the giant allium. It's a very strong flavor. And these are really earlier in the season, not quite summer, but they are worth planting. Society garlic.
Does the flower have a, I mean, is there like an odor of garlic?
No, surprisingly. The bee girls all over these suckers. And you'd think my honey would taste like garlic, but it doesn't. But that's an excellent question. Thank you for asking it. Well, here are my stargazer girls, right up against my shutters. And last year there were so many of them, I actually tied, I took the rebar stakes, and then I took that rubberized, vulcanized stake material, and I actually tied it to the house, to my shutters, because they were that heavy. Again, I presented that to my engineering husband, and I said, you have a large problem here. It is an engineering marvel. To be married to an NC State engineer is, well, it's just pretty much heaven. My husband got asked to go to California to do a speech for a national society. So I'm quite proud of him. And then a North Carolina favorite. Does anybody ever plant a surprise lily?
Mm-hmm.
Naked ladies. Now, do you know the story behind that? You know why they call them that? Because they don't have any foliage. You just got flowers. You're just naked. You just have the flowers. And don't they just come up like, I didn't plant you. Ha ha, do you like me here? I'm going to stay. All my licorice, they're all under the magnolia trees. It's like, come on out and play. So I dug them all up, and guess what happened? Yes. So I have a couple left, but naked ladies are really one of my new favorites. Well, here's my farm. On the left is my carriage house, and on the right is my old smokehouse. And it's really a lovely place to live. And I have cards. If anybody wants to come and visit my farm and my yard, July, August, I'd be happy to give you a little tour. We might have to have some grape juice. If you know what I mean. Lemonade, we could do that. So I will stop, we'll turn on a couple lights, and I will entertain some questions or whatever, and if everybody has a story they want to tell. I've been working for 10 years on my home. 10 years inside and out. Right proud of living in a historic home. I believe that it was our destiny to come here to preserve history and preserve lots of the things that happened. I have old, 100-year-old, century-old trees that you will not see anywhere else in Alamance County. I have some of the oldest trees in Alamance County on my property. So it's not just, you know, flowers. It's really a remarkable place. And it is a full-time job. So a couple things. I brought seeds of other sorts. If you are so inclined, you may take whatever seeds make your heart happy. The garden team decided that we wouldn't plant pumpkins this year.
Yes.
Oh, by the way, the lilies that I passed out, those are those lily salmon star. They'll be beautiful. So I have some flowers left that you are so welcome to have. Let's see, and seeds. And by the way, if you go to the NC State pamphlet site, There's an excellent chart, actually one of the references, on summer and fall flowering bulbs. It has a chart with what is really good recommended for NC, for North Carolina. So that was a good handout to get. Yes.
I have a question about fertilization.
Sure.
Do you fertilize your...
Well, that's an excellent question. I fertilize the earth around it, in it. I oftentimes get right down in there and take the bulb out and kind of give it a little shake and then amend that hole and then cover her back up and put her to bed. So I use very pine bark, really ground up leaves. I actually put it through a grater. I know. You know, like a compost grater. I know. That's why my flowers are gorgeous.
So
I don't put blue on it. I don't do any Miracle-Gro blue and stuff. I put only organic mulch and organic fertilizer that way.
Okay.
But I do fertilize. And I try really hard to water early in the morning, like 6 o'clock, and never the blossoms. So I think I'm sticking to that plan. I would really recommend that you just kind of think about it, and maybe you don't have time right now to plant some new things, but I hope that maybe some of the things that you saw might be interesting to you to plant.
I have a question. What would be the reason why, for example, the allium, what would be a reason that the allium doesn't bloom? I planted some about 3 years ago, and I thought I had lost them, and now this year they're blooming.
Okay.
So did I plant them too deep? Why would they?
That's an excellent question. My allium go in 4 to 5 inches.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes the quality of the bulb is not good.
Should have been.
But sometimes, yeah. Even, you know, as hard as you try, sometimes. But again, that's that sweet, that swift little Mother Nature. You really wanted alliums this year. yeah. Again, sometimes you'll plant something like a bulb and go, well, I know I planted something there. What on earth happened?
I was thinking maybe I just planted too deep.
No. If you plant things too deep, it takes longer.
Yeah.
But sometimes it's just that bulb's not ready to plant. It's not ready to sprout.
Okay.
And the very fact that it's sprouting now and growing now speaks to that.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
It would be my adventure to tell you, just keep hanging in there.
Okay.
For a lot of different things, don't you think?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, ma'am.
I have
Okay.
About 3 years ago, and I have a newer, this series, and it's beautiful, full sun, actually.
Yeah, slugs love them.
Huh?
Slugs eat the rhizomes.
I don't know why not. No, I'm having problems with these little white moths that are hitting right now.
Huh.
And they stitch the leaf while it's closed.
Oh, lovely.
And then the worms are inside.
Lovely.
I have to keep unstitching the leaf and open it up. And
man, to get the bloom for that canna.
Black grit in there, I'm guessing that's the egg.
Oh, man.
You don't know.
Some organic, or some, get rid of that, spray it with.
I don't know what to spray.
Epsom.
Insecticide?
Yeah, insecticidal soap and spray hard. But you have a lot of them? I mean, you have a lot of plants. They're in each plant?
Yeah. I love to get the whole.
You know what I would do? I would dig the whole sucker up. Dust them off. I know, but listen. Cause, you know, again, you know, when an infestation hits, you could lose the whole crop anyway. So you're trying to save your crop, right? I know this to be true. A lot of times you'll plant something and it's like, I would say to you, try to get in there and spray with insecticidal soap first, heavy water spray, and then that's going to maybe damage your flower. But well, that's basically what insecticidal soap is. It's just soapy water. You know, I'm the person who's taken all the I don't know the combination, but if you look up, you can get a recipe for what you mix and where. But I would try that first. But I would, you know, if I had that kind of, I tell you, it just makes you want to scratch your head and say why. I'm the person at the garden who picks all the Japanese beetles and puts them in. I delight in putting them in Clorox water and watching them die. I'm all about this. I mean, there's a sadistic side to me. You don't, you know. Yes, I'm sorry, were you going to have a little snack today? No. You still recording? What I really meant to say is, I don't know why God invented those. Yes, ma'am.
I got some peony bulbs.
Okay, pay attention here.
And they're like, no.
Peony.
Okay.
Yeah. Rhizomes.
Yes, and they're like little bean things, like nothing's hardly in there.
Okay.
And they've been planted, but then I started reading up on them, and I thought maybe they should have been planted in the fall. And these are not in your summer bulbs.
No.
Today. Okay.
Yeah, it's okay.
I should have planted it.
It's okay.
You know.
Okay, everybody, let's tell her it's okay.
But I'm not going to have any peonies now.
Well, but you know what? Here's the joy about planting. How nice of you that you came. Now you know something new.
Yeah.
You've been confirmed. You figured it out. How great. Mm-hmm. And now you can figure, well, there might be a few other little things I need to sort of adjust. Again, a master gardener, you adjust every year. And you think, who else can I ask? How nice that you asked. That, you know, again, for us to be skilled and successful in anything we do, we just need to surround ourselves with the best information and the nicest of people who will help us. And honestly, that's how I've become a master gardener, by really paying attention, reading vociferously. You know, I ask myself all the time, what else do I need to know? I mean, to be a dahlia expert, you got to really be smart. This is a great brand new book called Cut Flower Gardens. This gal, she's in Washington, and she's learned everything that interesting is by season, and she's got the dahlias by size and color, and she sells all the flowers to Whole Foods in the whole Northwest. Look at these buckets. She has those hoop greenhouses where she's growing them all year. But, you know, she's harvesting. I mean, look, can you imagine harvesting that many dahlias at one time?
Mm-hmm.
I don't think I can be her, but what a lovely opportunity to learn from her. So I've read her with great passion because she works probably 20 hours a day, and she's done very well.
What's her name?
Her name is Erin Benzakin. It's on the handout.
Thank you.
Okay, so does anybody feel a little inspired? Yes, ma'am.
Your mulch is all handmade, homemade, so to speak, or do you buy any?
I buy mushroom compost.
Mushroom compost.
Mushroom compost at the L place. You know the L place.
What is it for?
Luann knows what the L place is. I buy mushroom compost, and I buy finely grated pine bark.
Any place special?
The L place.
L place.
And it's only $2 a bag.
Oh.
And I buy it little at a time.
Okay.
Yeah, not the food store, that other one. I'm trying not to be. You can probably get it a lot of places, but I just happen to go there.
Gotcha.
Mushroom compost. It's beautiful. It's dark, rich, organic soil.
How do you mix in your chicken manure?
I don't mix chicken manure in my dahlia beds. Okay. I'm using that in my back garden for vegetables. But I'm using eggshells and coffee grounds in my mushroom mix. And we drink a lot of coffee. If you drink a lot of coffee, that's good. Because that's a nice pH for the dahlia babies. No, I don't have one of those because I have a well. So, you know, again, when you think about a farm. Okay, so if you want one of my cards, you're welcome to get one. I just am delighted that I was asked to be here, and thank you so much for your kind attention and your support. Yes, ma'am.
I wanted to ask a question about Dutch iris.
Yes.
Is that just regular iris?
No.
Okay.
It's a smaller version of the iris. It's not the bearded kind, and it really should not be in that brochure because it's a fall planter.
Okay.
Yeah. And I have lovely Dutch iris. They're a really pretty Delft blue with the yellow beard. They're lovely, and they're shorter than the beard, but they're beautiful. But they're really a fall bloomer. I mean, they're fall planter.
My neighbor has some that are in bloom right now.
Yes, mine are in blue.
Big purple.
Yep. beautiful.
White, you call that the beard?
Yeah, the beard. Ask her for a little snip of the cultivar. That'd be beautiful.
My husband said, just go by there one night.
No, ask her.
No.
You are welcome to come to my house. I'll share my Dutch.
Okay. So these are fall perks.
You plant those in the fall, so I didn't think that was accurate for summer bloomers. I put in a vinyl fence across my herb garden. Right in the track of a lot of bulbs. So I was just praying that when spring came and I did that, I hadn't destroyed my thing. So I didn't. It came up. The Dutch bulbs are up and they're happy. Now I just know I can plant more.
Well, this says plant in the spring, so that's not.
It's my understanding after a little research. You can plant them in spring, but they're not going to bloom in summer.
Okay.
They're going to bloom in spring. So if they bloom in spring, they should be planted in fall.
Right.
But again, I caution all of us just to say, now that Linda Lois said, most of the time, Dutch iris are springers.
Inside seven.
Beg your pardon?
Inside seven.
Correct. 7B, if you're going to have daffodils and iris, they're going to be planted in fall. And I consider fall up through January.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's still fall. Is it still not?
I planted some in February, and they are the prettiest ones I have in my garden.
Well, I went to Eden Brothers to their, I'm just going to tell you what I did, because I'm also frugal. I'm not cheap. I'm quite frugal, because, you know, I plant a lot of things. And I'm married to an engineer. Everybody understands that.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my God. And there's a budget committee meeting and all that. Okay, so my husband, Tim, who is a lovely man, says to me, I go, we needed more daffodils around the garden. Well, how many did you buy? I said, 750. Well, Linda, it's already March. I said, what's your point? He really is lovely. 36 years with me, my God. He should be solid gray and just, he should be at the Broughton place. But anyway, so we planted 700, well, I gave some to people. We have 750 new daffodils that are now blooming.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I planted them in March, so.
Wow.
And they're happy, and they're really nice colors. They're like peach centers and peach. Okay. My point is, you read about things, okay, and then adjust a little bit. But maybe you'll have better success at it in spring. So give it a try, and then Chris can call you next time, and you can give that speech. But I will say to you, half a life of being a planter is learning. And I learned that when I went to Monticello last year, and the Monticello gardener who was about, she was in her late 80s. Late 80s, this woman, she had a hat the size of Texas. And of course, everybody's asking these questions because, you know, we're at Monticello. And I'm making notes and taking pictures. And she says, well, here's how I've been doing it. I'm like, I'm doing it that way too. And you learn and you adjust and you plant new cultivars and things change. And so, thanks, y'all. Have a great day. See you soon.
Gardening classes are usually about two per month. So I think Green Thursday's class schedule. All different kinds of gardening topics. So we've done pruning. We'll have a class on vegetable gardening. We'll have a class on birds. We have a rain garden class, drought tolerant plants, fall lawn care. It's quite a long list of gardening classes we provide to the public to give them a better understanding of different gardening topics. All our classes are free and they're held at 10 o'clock on Thursday morning here in the Ag Building.